I used to tell my students in my classes, shouldn't be classes, it should be clashes. Therefore, you can interrupt. I may also interrupt myself, and I will never proceed without interruption. And that doesn't mean that mine would be a discontinuous lecture. It should be continuous. There will be coherence, but so many interruptions will come. And from my side, from your side, I expect those interruptions. And with these few words about my clashes with my students, today I am going to have another clash with you. Right? And the topic today, literally, here is crisis in knowledge. Let me start from the end. Knowledge. Can we define knowledge? I used to tell my audience, whatever I know is my knowledge, whatever you know is your knowledge. That's about all. Beyond that, nothing. Knowledge is what you know. Knowledge is what I... The more details I get, that is why Lyotard, the very famous theorist, French theorist, who wrote on the postmodern condition, he said that we are suffering or happy about the loss of faith. Please follow my words. We are, some are suffering, some are happy that we have lost our faith in truth. Some are suffering. How can we lose our faith? How can we lose our integrity of truth? Something like that. Some are very happy. You know, what is the first samar, what is the second samar? The first samar are the canonical, classical thinkers. The second half is the postmodern thinkers. See, unless we have lose our faith, and we won't lose our faith in truth, or what you call. Therefore, Lyotard was telling that, now we live in a sort of a post-truth world. We need not be worried about the truth. Because for everybody, truth changes. For a Hindu, what is truth is different from for a Muslim, what is truth. And that is different from what is truth for a Christian. Then where is truth? A unified, homogeneous truth, how can we arrive at that? See, don't you think that I am not a practicing Hindu, but I am a Hindu. You may be a practicing Muslim or you may not be a practicing. But the moment I utter the word God, the Hindus will take that word God for whom? Krishna, Godavari, Murga, things like that. Whereas if Muslims is, the audience is kaleidoscopic. Audience is kaleidoscopic, mixed. The Muslims will take it for whom? Allah. And after that, Muhammad is only a messenger of Allah, but he is not God. Therefore, for you, God would refer to whom? And a Christian is sitting somewhere there, he would connect that God with whom? But I entered only one signifier, God. How come that three different signifiers are available here? That means three different truths are available here. How do you able to get it? And therefore, there is no homogeneity. In terms of truth, you can't get any homogeneity. You get into a heterogeneity. But if you say that my truth is okay, that is where the hegemony comes. And that is why clash comes. If you insist on your truth, and hegemonically you insist on your truth, I insist on my truth, and he insists on his truth, and a girl is there now, why always it is his truth, his truth, his truth? Can't it be her truth? Can it be her truth? Because you intrude that gender. Then it must be her truth. Then where is truth? Then homogeneous truth. Therefore, no doubt, already we have been heading towards heterogeneity. We have been heading towards the multiplicity. But we are living under the impression within our boundaries. That's why I told you in April, we are living in a borderless world. We are living in a boundaryless world. But we think that we are living in a confined. Now, the more we are confined, the more we are restless. Because the more you are confined, the more you would hegemonistically insist on your truth. But you will never say that it is your truth, it is truth for everybody, but I may not accept it. Now the clashes, this is almost like in a molecular structure, a molecular form, the atoms are confined. The more they are molecules, a little bit free, molecular form. Atomic form, much more confined. And in a subatomic form, much more confined. The more you are confined, the more you will be restless. And therefore the humanity is today restless because of this truth. Because of this, because the more and more you are put into, even if you are parents, you go home a little late, your parents raise their eyebrows, why are you coming 6:30? And would you tolerate that? Would you say, man, I am more than 16, don't confine me. Therefore I am telling you, this confinement, the density of the confinement, if it is much more, then the restlessness would be more. And nowadays humanity suffers from this restlessness. I am saying humanity. I am not saying a confined humanity. That is why this fellow, Guattari, you must have heard something about the schizoanalyst Guattari. He said that, who can be happy in the world? Only a Paitikaran can be happy in the world. A schizo. Who can be happy in this world? A schizo. Because he leads unasked, a boundaryless, a decolonized world he is living. All the familiar world, a psychotic patient is completely cut off from reality. A schizo is completely cut off from reality. Therefore, he is very happy. But can we be schizos? And schizo as a hero. Schizo as a... Can I be completely cut off from reality? Like a psychotic patient? And such a solution can be accepted from Guattari. Or should it turn out to be complete? Even at least in neurotic patients would have a little bit relationship with their surroundings. Not a completely cut off from reality, but a psychotic patients like a coma patients, schizo patients, they will be in the classroom, but they will be thinking that they are cooking in the kitchen. Two places, living at the same time, simultaneously in two places. And this cut off from reality alone can make a human being say happy. Do you want that kind of a life? That is also very bad. And we can't, see, quite invite that I should be a madcap to be happy. And that kind of a thing is also extreme. And this too much extreme. Completely cut off, completely. You must have read Mrs. Moon's versus that novel, Mrs. Galloway. There you must have come across a shell-shocked man, Septimus Warren Smith, living with his wife. And he lives in his world, but she tries to pull him out of his interior world, interior scape. But in his interior scape, he is very, 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 very happy. But she couldn't bring. The doctor comes, and he couldn't bring. At last, he wants to live in his interior scape by committing suicide. Because he couldn't tolerate the impingement of his surroundings over his individuality, over his interior ship. Therefore, I am telling you, we are offered extremes to be happy, but can we accept these extremes? That is where literary theories are coming. Because in the 60s, in the 70s, literary theories, not literary, in fact, they are not literary theories at all. They are theories from different disciplines. Entered the English department to undisciplined English department. This is most important, please understand. Theories from sociology, theories from psychoanalysis, theories from gender studies, theories from different disciplines. theories from different disciplines, they have entered the English departments, almost the old purists in our departments, the crusty old purists, moralists in our departments, and their lucky dupes, lucky crannies in the departments, were raising their eyebrows like anything. When we are teaching literature, where is the need for theories? We won't allow our department, our discipline, to be undisciplined by the interdisciplinary theories. Please understand how we fight against theories, sorry, against disciplines which confines us. About 60 years back, our department of English literature all over the world are doing a hand pick up a place. A hand pick up poems, a hand pick up dramas, a hand pick up essays. With that we will start the game. And some sensational things we would say about Shakespeare, about the plays, about the drama, with that we will get a degree, but always worried about whether the verb in the text is rightly placed or not. More worried about whether Shakespeare has put the verb in the right place or not. Whether this fellow Hawkins put the verb in the right place or not. This is what we were worried about. That is why when theories entered the purpose of English department, putting a very, very disturbing question about the discipline of the discipline English literature. My dear fellows, what are you teaching? My dear fellows, what are you teaching? I am telling you, already the English departments all over the world were suffering from budget recut. Science departments getting more budget, whereas our English department, I could remember some of the departments in some of the colleges all over the world, I am telling you, they have to enlist numbers to meet the budgetary bottom line. You should enroll. I remember some of the teachers parting their money with to enlist students. Otherwise, even that budgetary bottom line will be out. That the 100 rupees won't be given to the department. You should run the show. This is how the English departments all over the world have lost their prestige, have lost their place on the pedestal. It is at this point, 60s, 70s, theories from other disciplines entered the English department. Telling all what happened in Duncan and Macbeth case. Duncan visited whom? Macbeth. Who was killed there? Duncan was killed. But here who is killed there? Macbeth is killed. The host department is killed. The host department is killed. The guest is driving the host out of the room. It is almost like in Tamil brothers, a proverb, Vandavanda Pidari, Ooth Pidariya Veratichas. The guest who has come to the host's house has dribbled whom out? The host out. It is an inverted Duncan Macbeth now. Happened in English departments in the 60s and 70s to counteract the entry of theorists. But this killing was a justified brutus like a justification was given. Yes, we have killed English department only for whose sake? For the sake of the English department. A brutus like a justification given by the theorists from across the disciplines, yes, we killed because already English department, mercy killing we have done. So that in the future we can recover the prestige, the lost prestige. Therefore, extend, widen, elaborate your space. The literary space was elaborated. Please understand. Because of the entry of theories, what happened? The area of our operation. Nowadays, the dancers dance not on the podium, but in the along with the audience, extending the place, the area of your occupation. Are you able to get my point?
Yes,
I get. The disciplinarity of the discipline in English was questioned. It was put on hold, but the textual space of literary text was widened like anything, plasticized like another. And so that what happened? English department started running courses on women's literature, on gender, on post-colonial literature. And now look at the areas that was offered to you. And most of the cultural studies should have done more in the English department than in the sociology department. The right place for them to do cultural studies is the sociology. Or some other department, at least anthropology. But what they have to do, but we are doing getting PhD. But what is the fun of every year getting PhD, whether Shakespeare has placed his wife right or wrong? This is our research. We have to write monographs. In those times only 10 students. Nowadays when I left the department, I taught in every MA class 100 students. 100 monographs they have to write. And 100 people saying that, this is so-and-so, Jane Austen hasn't put the verb rightly in that place. Now, what kind of an idiocy, we would have faced such things. Therefore, the textual space, please understand. You might give, that is where the whole problem comes. That is the textual space of the literary text is far and wide. But that kind of an elasticity, a chemistry text cannot afford to. A physics text cannot afford to. Even now, me like people doing a literary study of chemistry theories, I am doing. What is it? What am I doing? A literary study of a chemistry text I am doing. And day after tomorrow, I am going to do that. In that, the mega conference. Whether they can withstand a literary study, but we can withstand any number of studies. Because as Strobridge said, we distinguish here, but not separate here. A biologist, a botanist will cut the flower into different parts, but after that, the flower will be out. But we cut our story into different parts. This character, that character, this character. But do you think that our story will be divided into? This is what Strobridge said. Distinction is not a division. For the scientist, distinction is a division. A zoologist cutting the cockroach into so many parts. A cockroach itself is a micro thing. And we are expected to, in my laboratory, zoology laboratory, my zoological laboratory assistant, the teacher would ask me, come on, take the reproductive system out of cockroach. How will you take it out? Even the microscope you put it? And the where is the reproductive system? Where is the respiratory system? Where is the excretory system? We don't know. But that fellow will ask us to take it out. But we will do something like, and then this is he himself doesn't know. But it is his ignorance we got all the marks. But do you think that when we analyze a poem, when we analyze a short story, when we analyze a drama, all these fellows now started saying, because of the budgetary cut for the humanities departments, science is getting much more budgetary reallocations and locations. Therefore, our people saying, new critics, Vanderbilt University, they said, we are also scientifically analyzing your short story. Look at it. See, scientifically we are analyzing a drama. Scientifically, we are analyzing, piece of something like that. And all of a sudden, Wimsort groups, proliferation of texts, understanding poetry, understanding fiction, understanding drama, understanding an essay, as if before that we haven't understood it. Because this scientific spirit has, like viral fever, has got into the realms of the English department fellows. We are doing scientific study, scientific analysis of portfolio, scientific analysis, much more than a chemistry, much more than a physicist, much more than a zoologist, much more than a botanist. We analyze scientifically, like that. Even they were not happy about their scientific method. When they have lost faith in their scientific method, Einstein, the Heisenberg, like a quantum physicist, Schrodinger, like people, we are not happy with the scientific method. We want more poetic methods in our analysis of atom. Please understand. You go to Schrodinger, he is telling, I am ashamed of being a quantum physicist because I have to tell more lies. I have to tell more lies. I have to use more metaphors, like the poets. And you think that only poets use metaphors, but we scientists use much more metaphors. And even Schrodinger is defining what is a metaphor, like I.A. Richards. Like I.A. Richards, he is defining what is the metaphor, what is the metonymy, like that, because. And as another American Nobel laureate physicist said, Eddington, I think, he said that, and so many times we encounter no situations where it seems to be more literary than scientific. And we use metaphors, we use metonymies, because we come across an atomic behavior of a subatomic particle like the electron, and then suddenly it switches from one orbit to another orbit. We couldn't explain. It seems to be poetic. It is in poetry, there is no causal relationship. Dispensing with the causal relationship, one item would operate against or in terms of, because if you are against somebody, now you should have some cause. He is more beautiful, sir, therefore I am happier. Some would be happy about it, some would be unhappy about it. Just to put two girls together, they would be always unhappy. Why? You know that. There is a cause. I am saying, our phenomena, our behavior is cause-bound, cause and effect. But these fellows say, only in poetry, there need not be any cause or things like that. My atom behaves like that. My electron behaves like that. All of a sudden, a neutron switches its allegiance from, then come out. Spontaneous radioactivity. What is it? Spontaneous radioactivity. Artificial radioactivity with the atom bomb. But spontaneously atoms split. Spontaneously, when the spontaneous radium, the credit goes to the only woman scientist in the world. Can you tell me who is it?